Hi, everyone. Welcome to everyone who came in this rainy day in Philadelphia here to Gladfelter Hall, and welcome to everyone out there who is tuning in to listen to this iteration of the Dance Studies Colloquium coming from Temple University. It's my great pleasure today to introduce my colleague Elizabeth Claire, who is Associate Professor of Research in History in Paris at the Center for Historical Research, CNR, which is known as the CNRS, where she co-directs with Sylvie Steinberg the Gender History Research Group. A founding member of the Cultural History of Dance Workshop at, and I'm at these English versions of these titles sound strange to me, the Advanced School for Advanced Studies and Social Sciences, EHESS, École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales, where she has been producing an ongoing colloquium in historical dance studies for many, many years. So it's a very important site in Paris for dance scholarship. She publishes on the cultural history of dance, medicine, and gender. She's edited a number of Clio, Women, Gender, History in 2017, and with Alessandro Arcangeli, she's edited an issue of the Italian journal Ludica on the cultural history of performance, politics, and play. Current research projects include a manuscript about the medical history of social dancing and the gendered imagination in the late 18th century Europe, a book-length collection of articles in French, edited in collaboration with Beatrice de Laurenti, Roberto Poma, and Cohen Vermeer on the history of the body and the powers of the imagination from the Middle Ages to the 19th century in Europe, and finally, another ongoing project, interdisciplinary one, Disorienting Bodies, in collaboration with Mariem Gayous and Felicia McCarran. So a lot of exciting projects in the offing. But today she's going to speak to us about imagination. So welcome, Elizabeth.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for this lovely introduction, and certainly also for the invitation to be here. And welcome to all those of you who are here virtually. I do hope that it will be possible for you to follow along and ask questions. So today I'm coming to speak with you on a topic which I've been working on for quite a number of years. I have a current personal book in progress that examines how dancers, doctors, and philosophers in Europe in the 1790s and 1800s contended with the imagination's corporeality. That is to say, how they framed the role of imagination in their discourses about danced expression, artistic creation, emotional expression on stage, and the transmission of affect and idea through dance. I'm also investigating how medical practitioners of the new science of mental medicine in France, inheriting ideas that were developed by the Montpellier Medical School of Vitalism, considered the imagination's embodiment of idea in dance practices taking place outside the frame of the theater and outside the space of the theater. These physicians tended to look at corporeal expression of idea in passionate dancing as contagious, particularly when the imagination stimulated what they called nervous sympathies. And these nervous sympathies allowed experiences to be transmitted among certain categories of people, that categories established by the physicians, who they considered were naturally similar to one another. So the main category I examine is women, which is something that was a pertinent category of organization, anthropologically speaking, for the physicians at that time. But of course, you can also think of other categories. One of the others that's quite recurrent is a category they called people from the South, which was never clearly defined. Sometimes French people are part of the people of the South, and other times they are not. So it's a quite interesting tool to look at the different categories that physicians came up with to try to understand how the body functioned. My work on the cultural history of embodied imagination in dancing seeks to clarify how the mental faculty was at once validated for its capacity to engender artistic creation, theorized as a mechanism that empowered physicians in diagnosing and even curing diseases, yet also vilified for its association with pathology and contagion, particularly when the embodiment of ideas in dancing was attributed to the work of the female imagination and to dances that lacked an author. Dancing, and especially cases of passionate or enthusiastic dance, whether choreographed and staged, composed or improvised in social settings, offers a formidable case study for exploring historical notions about the embodiment of idea, the gendered politics of authorship, and the political right to imagine. In order to highlight some of the key concepts at work in the philosophical questions about the imagination that concerned the historical actors whose work and texts I study, I propose today to look at three keywords that recur in the various historical sources on dancing: eloquence, passion, and contagion. Each was considered to be an influence upon or a product of the powers of the imagination as observed by those who wrote and recorded their thoughts on passionate, enthusiastic dance in the final decades of the 18th century. Eloquence, in discussions of theater dance, was a stated objective of dancing masters whose reforms sought to legitimize a poetic form of ballet. In 1754, Louis de Cahusac published a treatise, La danse ancienne et moderne. How do we get this to move forward? Sorry. Down. No. It doesn't seem to respond. On the mouse. Okay. That's a bit laborious. Is there a way to?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah,
wonderful.
It should work.
Okay. Thank you very much. So, a treatise on the history of dance, which he categorized as ancient dance and modern dance. It was in fact a kind of manifesto for the creation of a modern dance, which he argued would require reforming how dancers were educated, particularly as related to the study of the human passions. The ballet master Jean-Georges Nevers, inspired by Cahusac, developed what he would call the ballet d'action and theorized that this action ballet would be capable of expressing and transmitting the human passions through a process in which the imagination played a significant role. The human passions, to get to the next keyword, refers to what we today would call emotions, so anger, fear, love, jealousy, hatred. The passions were an important consideration not only in the theorization of the art of ballet, but in medical discourse, and this had been the case since antiquity. The human passions were thought to influence the balance of the body's humors, and most diseases had been attributed to imbalances within this humoral system. As French medicine at the end of the 18th century shifted towards a vitalist model, and understandings about electricity and the nervous system came to replace the humoral model of the body, physicians still sought to explain certain pathologies as resulting from the imbalance of vital fluids. The imagination influencing and redirecting the movement of these vital fluids was therefore thought to lead to a variety of pathologies. Finally, contagion was framed as an important process both for the art of dance and for the art of medicine. The act of transmission of the passions in the aesthetic practice of ballet was what allowed dance to function like painting or like poetry. However, contagion was also understood as a potentially uncontrollable aspect of the function of the imagination and its powers. This risk became particularly pertinent in cases of enthusiastic dancing that were not choreographed per se. When the quasi-mathematical orderliness of the aristocratic belle danse was abandoned for a more sensual kind of social dance practice after the revolution in France, for example, physicians suddenly began to study social dancing as belonging to a category of sexual pathologies related to the interference of the imagination. So we'll look in more detail at these phenomena and the historical theorization of eloquence, passion, and contagion in dance. But first, let me go ahead and set the stage historically for those who may not be familiar with the medical history or the dance history for the second half of the 18th century in France. It may also be useful to briefly go over some of the basics of this period. The 1790s and 1800s in France were two remarkable decades, a time of great social upheaval, colonial expansion, imperial politics, the French and Haitian revolutions, and the Napoleonic Wars. A series of legislative changes radically restructured the institution of marriage in France during this same period. In 1792, civil marriage was legalized for the first time, And with this came the legislative right to divorce and the possibility for women to inherit property. However, Napoleon's government reversed most of the gains in civil liberties for women. In 1804, his civil code legally mandated paternal authority within the family structure, and women were once again assigned a dependent status that would take more than a century of women's movements to undo. After the fall of Napoleon, under the restoration of the Bourbon monarchy in 1816, the right to divorce was formally eliminated. So 1792 to 1816 is a very brief period. It would not be until 1884 that women could once again seek a divorce in France, and not until 1965 that a married woman had the right to open a bank account without the signed approval of her husband. The short period between the 1789 revolution and the restoration in France also marked a period of restructuration in the medical profession, a time when physicians took on a new civic role and invented the idea of the administrative structures to support their monitoring of what would become known as public hygiene. So we've just had a very big experience of medicine and public hygiene with the epidemic, and we've seen how different countries can apply this concept differently. Yeah, so this is something that was a very new idea, the idea that there could actually be a collective hygiene or a concept of public health or hygiene was basically just beginning at this period. We can read, for example, in the Annals of Public Hygiene and Legal Medicine that following the liberalization of the medical profession under the revolution, physicians considered that they could no longer limit themselves to studying and curing diseases, but needed also to establish and maintain what they called an intimate rapport with social organization, helping legislators to create new laws, informing magistrates how to apply those laws, and surveying, along with the administration, how best to maintain this new public health. Dancing, particularly social dancing in this context, came to be surveyed and regulated thus not only by the police and the military who guarded the theaters and the dance halls, but by the medical professionals who collaborated with the new administrative structures, such as the Paris Council for Public Salubrity that was part of the police prefecture starting in 1802. Much can be said about this particular period in dance history also, for the second half of the 18th century saw a multiplication of dance theory publications. We've mentioned one of them, Cahuzac. There's also the famous letter exchange between Noverre and Angiolini. Our friend Juan is an expert in that, so you can ask him all about that in a few weeks. A proliferation of debates in letters published between philosophers and dancing masters who participated actively in theorizing the reform of the theater arts, including dance. It was also a period that witnessed the beginning of what would become, by the 1830s, a massive feminization of the dance profession at the Paris Opera. And finally, the second half of the 1790s witnessed a reconfiguration of elite social entertainment. The liberalization of the professions not only affected physicians, but also dissolved the corporations which had structured French society prior to the revolution, and led to a diversification of public spaces that were accessible for dancing. Social dance fashions were thus no longer dictated exclusively by court fashions. With the rapid multiplication of pleasure gardens that provided spaces for new popular dancing to develop, the types of dancing performed on stage by the professional ballet dancers and the social dancing that illuminated the ganguette, the lemonade houses, and other dance halls began to develop independently. In 1799, Louis-Abel Beffroy de Régny, a journalist who also wrote regularly for the theater and the opera, published the first three volumes of an ambitious editorial project. His Dictionary of Neology proposed to its readers a veritable encyclopedia of all remarkable ideas, people, and objects that had contributed to or resulted from the revolutionary event, including words or practices whose meanings had been permanently altered by the experience of the revolution. Beffroy de Régny's dictionary project, begun 99 years after the royal institution of the first public ball in France, was ultimately censored when Napoleon came to power, and thus the project was never completed. As a result, only articles for the first three letters of the alphabet were finally published. So although we cannot consult his opinion on dance or dancing, which the author does indicate in another entry, quote, merits significant development. Dance historians are a little lucky in that the volumes do include entries for ball, ballet, balladin, and a new word, bastrang, which was invented during the revolution to account for the new practices in the popular balls. Beffroy de Rémy's article on the public balls confirms what other chroniclers of the revolution, like Mercier, better known, had also commented upon. Public balls, and now I'm reading from this dictionary entry, public balls were never so common in Paris as during the course of our revolution. It would seem as if we needed to seize fervently every means possible to shock and overwhelm the unhappiness that oppressed us from every direction. It is a truly singular characteristic, this French casualness that passes suddenly from tears to joyful enthusiasm, from the scaffolding to the dance. The article Ballet illustrates how quickly the everyday practice of dancing evolved as a result of the revolution. Beffroy de Rémy laments, "We no longer dance ballets in our societies anymore, although this kind of dance had been so much more delightful than today's villain waltzes that have turned our women into spinning clogs. And these new dances don't offer any pleasure aside from the fact that a young man can seize and squeeze beauty in his arms." And I usually don't do this, but this is not an illustration from a dance manual and should not be considered a realistic interpretation of the waltzing, but it does give you at least a sense of the costume, which might have made the breasts an important feature of this new dance, and they are regularly mentioned when this closed couple hold is brought up. So Beffroy de Rémy continues, "Ugh, but the spectator, these waltzes are so stupid, so stupid, so stupid. However, they come to us from Germany, and all that which is not French is considered so beautiful, so beautiful. At least in a ballet, the spectator could find pleasure in the development of gracefulness between two svelte, slight people who, as they were not to be confused with a half dozen others, were obliged to make themselves remarkable by maintaining a decent posture and by the accuracy and lightness of their steps." The author opposes the German waltzes with the ballet d'action that he claims in another article lifted the theater to its absolute highest degree of splendor. And he praises the inexhaustible genius of Gardel, who provided the Paris Opera Theater with the chef d'oeuvre of Psyche, Paris, Télémaque, and La Dansomanie. Otherwise, we could translate that as Dance Mania. Very, very popular ballet in 1799-1800. Today, I would like to share with you a thought experiment based on Beffroy de Rémy's reading of the cultural opposition between the vertiginous sensual pleasures of the German waltzing and the newly elite classes preferred to experiment with at the Tivoli Gardens, and the artistic masterpieces of the Ballet d'Action composed by a dancing master like Pierre Gardel, whose Dansomanie would take up this very opposition in relationship to the pathologies of the imagination as its central subject for his composition in 1800. So to recap, where the popular culture of the decade prior to the revolution, so the 1780s, had been a decade marked by the invention of the hot air balloon, fascination with Benjamin Franklin's lightning rod, and the ethereal, windy music of his glass harmonica, as well as a veritable obsession with the theatrical cures proposed by Anton Mesmer. Some of you may have heard of mesmerism. We can get into that in the questions and answers. And his seance of animal magnetism. The late 1790s found Parisians reeling from the violence of the revolution and facing forward into Napoleonic imperial politics, the legislation of a nuclear family model determined to define women by their dependence on their husbands and their capacity to reproduce, and a vitalist mental medicine concerned with the pathologies of the imagination and its potential effects on public health. So I'm going to read two quotes which are very far apart in time, but I like them next to each other because they're both written by doctors who are attempting to understand a dance that is not properly choreographed. It's not theatrical dancing. These are dances that caused problems. So I'll begin with a quote by Paracelsus from 1531, his Causes of Invisible Diseases. He states, "She adopted a manner of dancing," and this is his analysis of the 1518 dance epidemic in Strasbourg, which is in the Rhineland area, where there were quite a number of these episodes of dancing, uncontrollable dancing. "So she adopted a manner of dancing and pretended that she could not stop dancing. for her husband disliked nothing more than dancing. In order to make sure that her actions had their full effect and had the likeness of a disease, she hopped and jumped high, sang and lulled, and did whatever it was that her husband hated worst of all. She jerked a while and after that went to sleep. She claimed that all of this had been a disease attack and said no more than this in order to make a fool of her husband. And then the next quote is from 1794. It's a debate that I develop in an article, so if it's interesting, you can consult the publication. A debate between a young Jewish salonniere from Berlin, young philosopher in her 20s, and a physician who she'd been childhood friends with, who she kept a correspondence with, whose name is David Witt. And they have a very lively debate about the qualities and the positive and negative effects of waltzing. So he writes, "Waltzing, where it seems as though madness tumbles wildly to and fro and yet turns orderly to the most beautiful beat, constitutes the most boisterous and potent form of dance, for that alone, and for that alone, is decried as dangerous, because the forceful movements awaken a storm in the whole body, and all senses and all passions are set into a lively game by the pleasant agitation of the blood." So separated by a quarter of a millennium, these two physicians' words implicating dance, disease, and madness point to a longue durée connection in European medical philosophy between the powers of the imagination and the perilous nature of the dancing body. The historical actors I study were concerned with the moral and social implications of the expression of human passions. Reading how the body articulated what we today call emotions provided a particularly rich territory for philosophical analysis in a variety of domains. For European philosophers from antiquity to the Middle Ages and well into the Enlightenment, the mental faculty of the imagination, stimulated by art or love, devotion or illness, was debated and theorized as being at once intangible and yet precisely located in the body. So I want to be very clear, because oftentimes, especially in literary studies, I don't know if anybody is in comparative literature or studied literature, there's a word we use often called the imaginary. And this is something quite different, because the historical actors I'm studying really were looking at different parts of the brain. And the imagination was a component. So considered a physical component of the brain. And you can see there are several different areas of the brain. The two that interest us most today are fantasia, or fantasy, and imaginativa, or imagination. We also have, you can see, you know, the olfactory senses and gusto for taste, sensus cogitativa, which is reason. You also have memorativa, which is memory. And so these different factions or parts of the brain were explored in how they interacted with one another. The imagination was thought to have different powers to have effects on the body. And these effects in much of this medieval literature is often divided into a sort of a hierarchy of three different kinds of effects. So there's the very basic form, which was never particularly contested, where the imagination, when influenced by imagery that it receives, so imagination has the word image in its root, right? So the body receives through its senses an image, and that image can act upon our body. So a classic example of this would be blushing. So you can actually see the physical effect on the body of the person who has received the image and whose imagination is thus activated by that image. A second level, which was really an accepted part of medicine for hundreds and hundreds of years, and only in the 18th century really becomes refuted, and even then there are still places you can observe it's being actively supported in medical literature, and also by many women who contested when this belief came to an end, is called envie des femmes, which translates as female desires. And it's a very specific period of time when the imagination was considered to have a potent possibility for imprinting through the images that were received on the female imagination of the pregnant woman onto the fetus. So We even have remnants of this today still in English. I don't know if anybody knows someone who has a strawberry birthmark, for example. But the idea, a concept of this in medicine is that if a woman who was pregnant wanted to eat strawberries and could not get them, that this desire, because of the power of the imagination, could imprint the fetus with the image of the strawberry. That's a very lightweight version. Sometimes this was also used by medicine to explain what they called monstrous births. So here you have monstrous births are when the child who's born does not resemble its parents for any number of reasons. So you have a version here where perhaps a woman would have seen some kind of hairy animal which would have scared her, and this image, because it touched her passions and so strongly heated her imagination, impressed upon the fetus, and the fetus, when it was born and became a child, was hairy. Or another example, also here, you have an example of a white mother who gave birth to a black child. And this could also be explained through the powers of the image and the imagination of the pregnant woman. So this is a kind of a hinge case example, because for a long time, the fetus was considered integral entirely and part of the female body. But as medicine progressed and the fetus came to have an independent identity, or a liminal, partly independent identity, it became possible to imagine in medicine that there could be a third category of how the powers of the imagination could work. And in this third category, you could actually, through what they called action at a distance, the power of the imagination of the person who was receiving the image could stimulate a change in the body of someone else or on another object. A very basic example of this is yawning. So this theory of action at a distance was used to explain when you see someone yawn, it makes you yawn also. So there were different debates in the medieval theology that tried to understand the different functions of the imagination. The imaginative faculty had long been contemplated for its role as a conduit between the celestial and the corporeal, a means of communication and transmission linking the body and the soul. And in sources from the early modern period in Europe, the human imagination is often presented in a negative fashion, considered as a mental faculty that, while connecting body and soul, was often capable of provoking illusions, errors of thought, or even sinful behaviors. The powers of imagination were understood as particularly Aquinas framed the notion of action at a distance as a process of contagion, by which the thoughts or the imagination of an individual, the fascinator, could indirectly modify another body that was connected to a soul, the fascinated person, and by an intermediary movement of the heart would change the physical aspect of the fascinated person or somehow influence their mind. The evil eye of the fascinator was described as infecting the air with vapors, specious, or simply a spiritual substance that in turn would have an altering effect on the body of another being. This notion will make an appearance in the philosophical movement to reform the art of ballet. This is my argument. We'll see if the audience agrees. In the creation of a dance in action, and was also theorized with respect to the potential for political mobilization and the contagion of ideological fermentation in the theaters during the revolution. So just to give an example of this, there was a reform to get rid of the chairs, to put chairs in what we now call the orchestra section, which was a way of separating the bodies sufficiently so that they couldn't fire each other up and create political mobilization in reaction to something that was being delivered or seen on stage. During the Renaissance, the powers of the imagination, heretofore theorized by medical philosophers in connection with the terms of compassion, sympathy, and contagion, acquired further negative associations to become inextricably linked with illicit practices of magic and charlatanism. However, medical discoveries in the 17th century, resulting from new practices of human dissection, improved understandings of the circulatory and the nervous systems in the body, and led to a gradual shift in conceptions about how the imagination connected the body to the outer world through the transmission of sensation. Finally, the discovery of electricity and the variety of 18th century public experiments using electricity to touch and to move the human body offered new scientific methods and also shifted popular opinions and understandings of how to integrate the powers of the imagination into a secular understanding of its effects on bodies. In the 18th century medical and philosophical treatises consulted, dancing appears to have incarnated and rendered visible the most significant and controversial functions traditionally assigned to the powers of the imagination. That is to say, this third level of the powers of the imagination where you would affect another person. And while these controversial effects of the imagination connected back to classical discussions and medieval scholastic debates, the notion of artistic genius and human creativity distinguished the late 18th century discussions. Ranging from analyses of enthusiastic delirium to arguments about artistic originality and the sublime, debates about the imagination in late 18th century texts that theorized about dancing understood the mental faculty as the embodiment of a uniquely human capacity for poetic creation and communication of emotions. French philosophers of dance, in particular, invoked the powers of the imagination and enthusiastic effects of their gestural art as a means to legitimize choreography as a poetic, liberal art, with the aim of lifting ballet away from its long-heralded status as a mechanical art of support in support of aristocratic social and political power, carving out a new role for the art of ballet on the theater stage. Borrowing vocabulary developed by the 17th century theoreticians of sacred Christian rhetoric and discussions of the art of persuasion in ecclesiastical oratory, philosophers of ballet in the 18th century translated ideas about how predicators were supposed to excite faith through their oratory, transforming these notions about persuasion and applying them to the art of ballet. Whereas Antoine Arnauld, in his Reflections on the Eloquence of Predication in 1695, argued that the essential task of eloquence in Christian oratory was to act principally on the heart. Noverre, for example, employed this notion in his argument about ballet's ability to force hearts into sensibility. If properly composed and interpreted to excite, ballet would thus be capable of moving hearts, just as religious rhetoric had excited faith in Christian congregations. According to Philippe Roussin's informative work on rhetoric, contagion, touch, and sympathy, the predicator was to touch hearts by making an appeal to the passions. He cites Crevier, who suggested one had to, quote, speak to people's senses in order to illuminate their reason, and argues that the rhetoric of the counter-reform movement developed a discourse about the heart and rehabilitated the passions as a means of touching people, working against 16th century neo-stoicism and a theological philosophy that considered the passions a mere effect of original sin. The 18th century theorization of ballet as an art of the passions transformed theological discussions of the power of rhetoric to touch and persuade with eloquence into a discourse about the eloquence of gesture and dance's capacity for such persuasive action on stage. At stake in the 18th century reframing of theatrical dance, and for our purposes, the French art of ballet, was dance's relationship to the embodied performance of idea and to the transfer of emotion from performer to spectator. Louis de Carouzac, who often collaborated as a librettist, go back to this, on lyric operas composed by Philippe Rameau, was one of the major contributors to the Enlightenment's debate about the art of dancing. Carouzac provided a theoretical foundation for the reforms that Jean-Georges Noverre would put into practice and institutionalize at the Paris Opera. Carouzac contributed various articles on dance to Diderot and D'Alembert's Encyclopedia project, including contributions on ballet, enthusiasm, fête or structured parties, figurant, which I haven't found a good translation for, figurant, extras, we say in a movie, but I don't know what the word would have been at the time. Did you come across figurant at all in American? Figurant, the dancers who are not soloists and not part of, yeah. I don't have a good English word for that.
Oh, the extras, yeah.
Yeah, extras. I'm not sure how we would have referred to it at the time, but today in movies we call them extras. So those people who don't have a character,
walking-ons.
Where I lost my place now. And gesture. So Cahuzac, in his article in 1751 on ballet, volunteered a single but important complaint about his favorite ballet featuring the much admired vedette ballerina Marie Salée. While Cahuzac appreciated Sallé's exceptional performance, he regretted that no action animated the work. One dances, he wrote, just for the sake of dancing. According to Cahuzac, this problem needed to be addressed. In 1754, he pursued his meditations on ballet, publishing a dense three-volume treatise on the art of dance. Do you see the cover here to the third volume? In which he proposes the creation of a dance in action that could constitute a modernization of the form. Cahuzac's work rehearsed a number of key points taken from the Abbé Dubos' very influential thesis on aesthetics, the critical reflections, which saw seven editions between 1719 and 1770. In this text, Dubos developed a doctrine of what he called aesthetic sentiment, which demanded that poetry stir hearts and by doing so induce the birth of the sentiment it hopes to excite. The poetics of sentiment, based on the idea that the art should communicate emotions, allowed Cahuzac to defend and legitimate the French art of ballet as one that could express and transmit passions. Blending Dubos' aesthetic sentiment with revised mechanics of artistic enthusiasm and applying this to the art of gesture, Cahuzac's theory suggests carving out a significant role for the powers of the imagination in the development of the modern dance in action. Dancing, which results in a lack of image, he wrote, is none other than a bizarre production without art, without life, and in bad taste. Even for the art of music, whose intention Cahuzac stated was to move the listener through expression, he asserted there is no expression without painting an image. In many respects, Cahuzac was arguing for a poetics of dance in which the imagination and its action or force would serve as a theoretical basis for explaining how dance embodied and communicated ideas and passions through images. Such a positive interpretation of the powers of imagination, however, did require a little philosophical justification. For in the French memory, it would not have been possible to entirely forget the controversial 1733 episode of the Saint-Médard convulsionaries and the widely cited analysis provided by Dr. Hecquet, who ascribed the dance epidemic to the work of hysterical vapors of a uterine nature that spread by the contagious, troubled imaginations of young women who had succumbed to the epidemic. 1 year after his treatise on dancing appeared, Cahuzac published another article, Enthusiasm, in the fifth volume of the encyclopedia, affirming the urgency for the arts to determine a working definition of this enthusiasm, which he described as a sort of furor that takes over the spirit and masters it, then inflames the imagination, elevating it and rendering it fecund. In the article, Cahuzac argued for a destigmatization of the concept of imagination. Cahuzac attempted to draw the concept of imagination away from the commonplace notions of religious enthusiasm and madness in order to apply it to the idea of artistic genius. He depicted his notion of enthusiasm as a sort of transport that he wrote was illuminated by reason in its moments of grandest superiority. And this enthusiastic inspiration whereby the imagination transports the artist produced what Cahuzac called an eloquence, both noble and male. This noble male eloquence was to be the new objective of the art of ballet. Cahuzac concluded, "There is no creation without enthusiasm, and there is no enthusiasm without genius." Eloquence in dance, according to Cahuzac, would be tethered to the imagination of a male artistic genius. Cahuzac's theory for a dance in action sought to address a series of problems that he observed about aristocratic theatrical entertainment. First, that dancers remained unduly obsessed with tradition. Second, that the traditional noble dance was limited by its singular development of beautiful proportions, precise execution, and a search for extreme lightness in the composition of its steps. And finally, that performers clung to the notion of professional privilege, insisting that in any given lyric opera, they must be provided with two solo entrances, known as entrées in French, with which they would adjust according to their own whims and not necessarily in connection with the theatrical development that their dancing was adorning. Cahuzac concluded that unless dance was to remain an ornament without object, a futile exhibition of steps, and a cold composition of figures without spirit, without taste, and without life, then the poet, and he puts this in a capital letter, the poet of the ballet, its author with a capital A, must in some way or other seize the power from the dancers in order that he himself control the composition of the entree. To become poetic, dancing needed to express and transmit emotions and tell stories. But dancing also needed an author. This author of ballets would ensure that the dancing expressed sentiment in connection with the principal subject, thus attaining the character of imitation and the expression of action that would guarantee dance's poetic function and qualify it as a dramatic art in its own right. In Kauzek's treatise, he implored dancers to educate themselves in the human passions. "Elevate your work," he wrote. "Study the passions, know their effects, the metamorphosis that they perform on the characters, the impressions that they make, the movements they excite. Let your soul practice feeling. Your gestures will soon align themselves with your soul in expression. Penetrate the subject you must represent to the point of enthusiasm. Your heated imagination will retrace the different situations inside you in a fiery tableau. Draw yourself. Draw these tableaux according to your imagination. And Nauvert took up this challenge. "Dancers," he wrote in his 1760 Letters on Dancing, "must divide their time and their studies between the mind and the body, because spirit and genius do not reside in the feet." Spirit and genius were indeed products of the dance artist's informed imagination. In concluding his letters, he also suggests that dancers, in order to distinguish themselves by their morals and their superior talents, needed to complement their purely technical education in dancing with a similar study of culture, sensibility, and philosophy of the human soul. He wrote, "Dancers should dedicate themselves to painting and to feeling because they share the same objective. If the dancers are not deeply affected by their roles, if they do not take hold of the character with truth, they cannot flatter themselves to succeed. This truth, this enthusiasm that characterizes the great actor and which is the soul of the poetic arts is, if I dare express myself thus, the image of a bolt of electricity. It is a fire that communicates quickly, that instantaneously seizes the imagination of the spectators, unsettles their soul, and forces their hearts to sensibility." Mastery of ballet's capacity for action thus required philosophical study and a knowledge of how to embody and understand the depths and the function of the human passions. To produce that lightning bolt of communication capable of seizing the spectator's heart and unsettling their soul required dancers to cultivate their minds and prepare their bodies to articulate the powers of imagination, as he says, with truth. The writings of Kauzek and Nauvert taken together suggest a phenomenon by which dance artists were encouraged to stake a claim in the kind of action that theology had long argued was critical to moral persuasion. Through the study of passions and the embodiment of imagination, the dance artist could persuade his audience to feel, and from this feeling, perhaps, to act. The recurrent comparison between dance in action with the art of painting and visual tableau supports the idea of a visual poetics for dance, one that would build upon the philosophical tradition of contagion by imagination, and whereby performed gesture would touch its audience with the truth of an emotion. So we're going to switch gears, and we're going to go to this other article that was defined in this dictionary that I cited from 1799. And we're going to look at a phenomenon which was very significant in the outdoor dance spaces at the very end of the decade of the 1790s in Paris, and which would then later spread to other countries. But I'm also conscious of the fact that I am not keeping time with my own plan. So I'm going to try to synthesize as best I can. So I'm going to begin with a quote from a cousin of Jane Austen's who was traveling in November 1799, so the same year that the dictionary had been published, in Hanover. And she writes to Jane Austen, quote, "I saw the real German waltz for the first time. The man takes his partner completely in his arms, and they whirl round face to face." In an early passage of Goethe's polemical Sorrows of Young Werther, the hero narrates an experience of a waltz with Lotte, the heroine. Just to go very quickly, there was a dilemma, which is that this is the first dance with a closed couple hold. Sorry, I'm trying to resume like three pages and two sentences. So a closed couple hold, which became part of an entertainment for an elite class that had generally not practiced that type of hold. In 1784, Johann Anton Franz d'Aleyrat, an obscure writer but an apparent fan of Goethe's novel, published a small book about waltzing, which he directed to the ladies of Viennese high society. As best as I can determine, Vienna was a center for waltzing much earlier than Paris. I won't say that it originates from Vienna, but it does get popularized in Vienna. His book begins, "I do not require a confession, my beauties. I know in any case that your own experience will not punish me if I claim that every ball, even the most modest ball, gives the imagination a sensual impetus, intoxicates the mind, drowns out reason, lulls the heart in a soft tumult of inflamed desires, and melts wisdom and restraint, even in women." Seizing immediately upon the fact that waltzing intoxicates the imagination, d'Aleyrat admits that he's skeptical that the female imagination does not, quote, slip off into dishonorable desires just as easily as a man's. His little book of 14 pages spares no detail in its physical description of the effects of waltzing on the female body. D'Aleyrat explained how the fast-turning German dances that confused the spirit and the soul rendered a woman's sensations and passions transparent, communicating her true physiognomy. He could tell between the false prude, the fine coquette, the reckless, the proud, the voluptuous. He could see the innermost folds of a woman's soul when she danced. A waltz not only revealed one's true character, according to d'Aleyrat, it exhausted the body with a combination of symptoms that medical scholars would come to classify as a pathological form of vertigo, generating unnatural, voluptuous urges, ambiguous images, and all too sensual feelings, as it opened the heart to all dangerous impressions of indecency and impermissible freedoms. We are in the same realm of pathology as described in current medical works from that time period about the problems of reading novels, of masturbation, that made possible the pivoting momentum of the dance and gave form to what was called the closed couple hold, or in French, the prise fermée. Rather than performing memorized geometrical figures, the closed couple segments of the waltzes allowed for improvisation, and this aspect was emphasized in the most ludic versions of the dance. One called the galop, which was about going as quickly as possible from one side of the room to the other in these turning circles. Very little can be concluded from the material available about how the waltz was meant to be danced initially in France, for until a treatise in 1816 by a British dancing master, Thomas Wilson, where we learned that the French version had included an open series of marching steps performed side by side before turning in to pivot, there is no technical literature in France that remains to indicate how waltzing was either taught or performed in the period under Napoleon that interests me most, and which interests the physicians most. But many chroniclers confirm the veracity of this dance practice after the revolution. Louis-Sébastien Mercier described the dancing in the period following the fall of Robespierre as a universal fury that had everyone, from rich to poor, twisting about. The German poet Ernst Moritz Arndt describes the French nationalization of this German pivoting dance in very moralizing terms. He says that the closed couple hold allowed male dancers to squeeze the lady dancers as close as possible against themselves while placing their hands firmly on the breasts of their partners. Through touch, the exchange of perspiration, and a rapidity that solicited the imaginations of the dancers, the dazzling intimacy of the waltz was said to produce a ravishment that, according to the doctors who described it, were a menace to the health of an entire generation of youth. In 1807, this universal fury of dancing was described in the medical literature after the revolution in relationship to the questions of enthusiasm, passion, envie, this desire, and madness, a whole ensemble of phenomena in which the mental faculty of the imagination played a pivotal role. Doctors wrote about the force of the imagination to explain the collective contagion of revolutionary violence, a mental contamination linking a deviant behavior produced involuntary imitation, much like yawning. Following the same logic, waltz mania was understood in the medical community as an epidemic of deviant dancing that was transmitted via the imagination. In 1807, the Journal of Paris warned its readers of the possible side effects of this dance. Quote, "For years, husbands, mothers, and all reasonable people have spoken against the waltz. No other dance is more suitable for making women's heads spin and exhausting their organs. Last week, a woman sadly proved this. She left the child she was nursing to throw herself into the whirlwind of a waltz. The blood and milk went to her head. She barely had the time to say, 'I don't feel well,' when she dropped dead in the arms of her dance partner." As the physician Hippolyte Noël Aubeuf explained in his 1815 dissertation on imagination, quote, "The imagination, or more exactly, the possession in a lesser or greater quantity of this faculty, is nothing that we have control over. It must be taken as a product of the particular disposition of one's organs." 3 years later, in an essay on vertigo published by the physician Victor Bouzac, he categorized vertigo into two separate categories. Sorry, he distinguished two categories of vertigo: idiopathic vertigo and symptomatic vertigo. Symptomatic vertigo signaled simply the presence of another illness, like syphilis. Waltzing, however, produced a vertigo that belonged to the idiopathic category of vertigo, linking it to the imagination and to the limits of reason. According to several of the works that discussed vertigo and waltzing, women who were considered to have an innate sensibility and a naturally enhanced irritability and mobility in their minds were particularly susceptible to idiopathic vertigo, provoked by what they called aggressive exercises like waltzing, with its sensations of touch, rapid movement, and repetitive turning that blurred optical sensory input and heated the imagination. Simple waltz vertigo was considered an accidental vertigo because the derangement resulted from an outside physical cause acting on the body. But repeated experiences of waltz vertigo could lead to more dangerous forms of vertigo and additional related pathologies. A physician whose last name is Reparier confirmed this perspective about repetition and habit in his 1815 dissertation on vertigo. He wrote that the malady of vertigo, not unique to women nor to dancing, was, however, the result of a person's habits. He wrote, "Vertigo occasioned by exhaustion, either from the pleasures of sex or by office work, tends to be a prelude to other more serious infirmities." So he's talking really about excess. So either excess mental labor, that's why he refers to office work, or excess physical labor, sex, or dancing. The novelty of the medical discussions of imagination and waltzing lay in the fact that the physicians were exploring the impact of emotions on the body and the mind while connecting these phenomena to their reading of dance practices, which they categorized as habits. This allowed for a slippage between reading the dancing body and reading the expression of idea or desire through the body, which was part of the scientific experiment of the new mental medicine. Following the influential work of Cabanis, physiology, the analysis of ideas, and mental health became three branches of one unique unified science, which he titled the science of man. Another physician, citing Cabanis' authority, concluded in his thesis concerning the effects of the passions on women's health that sensibility is the essential connection between mental and physical health. Women's emotions were thought to be more intense because their passions would strike their imaginations more forcefully. Thus, physical habits and behaviors had an outsized effect. And conversely, the state of health of a woman's body was related to the state of her mental health. The physiological effect of ideas and emotions on the body justified medical intervention in the case of activities or habits, such as the waltz or reading novels, for example, which were clearly understood to impact sensibility and therefore mental health. Medical proscriptions of dancing in cases where women were already prone to symptoms of mania became very commonplace in the medical literature. In 1804, in a book on popular medicine called The Doctor of the People, a treatise on specifically female illnesses that was intended as an instruction manual for midwives. The physician writing suggests that marriage would be a useful treatment for women suffering from the initial symptoms of mania, but that dancing, and in this case he makes no distinction about what kind of dancing, would be, quote, very harmful. The connections established by physicians between vertigo and female sexual manias reveals a process by which medical considerations of the effects of the passions on the female imagination were used to question women's capacity not only for rational thought, but by association, preclude the possibility that the female imagination could be productive in aesthetic creation. While philosophical discussions of the powers of the imagination and the passions had been applied to the reform of theatrical dancing, works of artistic genius in dance were consistently attributed to the male figure of the ballet master. And this is also because of institutional reasons, which is to say that women just simply could not get the job of ballet master. It was exclusively for men. The medical discussions of imagination, passion, and the social dances accounted for in the post-revolutionary source material focused on the female body and the dangers that passionate dancing posed to women's health, the fragility of her naturally strong or susceptible imagination. Passionate and enthusiastic dancing in this case, as the various works cited above suggest, did not produce artistic genius, but rather tuberculosis, miscarriages, and an entire range of sexual manias, including nymphomania, clitoromania, hysteromania, erotomania, the list goes on. In 1804, as we mentioned earlier in our talk, the arrival of the German waltz in France coincided with the first publications of the new psychological and political science class of the National Institute in France, created in 1802. It was in connection, in the context of this political dynamic of early hygienism under the consulate, that waltz mania came to be understood within a longer genealogy of European choreic contagions. The 11th century legend of dancers of Kolbeck, Tarantism in Mediterranean Europe, the Wietztanz maligned by Martin Luther and discussed by Paracelsus, the convulsionaries of Saint-Médard in the 18th century, and even the ecstatic Quaker dances that were taking place simultaneously on the North American frontier. In 1804, Saint-Ursin, a physician and one of the most prolific to treat the dangers of the new close couple dances, published his book, A Friend to Women on Private Luxury and Waltzing, a medical text dedicated to Madame Bonaparte and written in a literary prose destined for specifically female readership. He cites the harmful effects of Goethe's novel, which begins with the waltz, and also laments the events of the revolution, which he claimed had deformed young women's morals. He describes the waltz as a battle of the sexes that, though through the confusion of the senses, upsets women's desires and destroys the bonds of marriage. As a male dancer embraces the waist of his partner with his nervous arm, the couple pivots, gazes merged, wholly absorbed in one another, and he says, they trace a multitude of circles in a state of delirium. The practice, according to Saint-Ursin, was responsible for a general contagion of dance mania in France. Other doctors considered that simply by observing a waltz, the nervous sympathies of a young woman could be activated, placing her as a spectator in a state of contagious mania in which she too risked sacrificing her mental health. In this way, the waltz participated in a social and medical debate centered on the powers of the female imagination and the question of republican motherhood. And these tensions were echoed in the satirical prints as well as the specialized presses. In the medical lexicon, a connection was established between the vertigo of the waltz, the exaltation or striking of the female imagination, and the contagious character of the dance, correlated to enthusiasm and emotional excess. In the French dance mania, physicians observed the enthusiastic passions of women waltzers on the dance floor and considered this responsible for a reversal of the natural order of things and the manufacture of mannish women attracted by masculine ambitions. They denounced the very vexing consequences that, as they put it, brought on by the exciting magnetic contact and by the false pleasures that waltzing induced. And I don't have time to develop it, but this notion of false pleasures goes back to the question of envie, or the desire, envie des femmes, which was that second category of how the imagination could impact the fetus. And it becomes clear if you really look at a lot of these different texts that underneath the pathological, let's say the construction of the pathology of vertigo, there is a fear in the medical community about the question of reproduction. So these false pleasures, like waltzing and the emotions that it could provoke, were in contradiction with what Louis-Jacques Moreau de la Sarthe and many other physicians posited as the natural phenomenon of the pleasures of maternity. If marriage, according to the Civil Code of 1804, was to serve as the foundational element of a modern republican society in France, the exaggerated pleasures of the waltz, and remember, we're still in a period where it's possible to get a divorce, ran contrary to this recommendation. In the wake of the revolution and its fervor, the proper channeling of the collective imagination was vital for the successful orchestration of governing the new imperial social body. The public balls remained an ambivalent space in this regard. On the one hand, they were controlled spaces monitored by municipal, military, and medical administrators. Yet they also legitimated a framework for the transmission of passionate practices that were susceptible to trouble the social order, especially when it came to gender relations. The circulation of medical discourse on waltz mania had the effect of rendering urgent, in the name of public health, the problem of the involuntary transmission of waltz's particular jouissance. The objective was to avoid a moral contagion of these perpetual dances that might lead to a collective female mania imprinted with revolutionary passions, female desire, and republican ideas of equality. Thank you.
Check one, two, check, 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 one, two.
Great, thank you, Elizabeth. We're opening the floor for questions and comments. We have a mic so that the audience outside can hear if you. So if anyone wishes to say something, we'll bring you the mic. Okay. You didn't like that.
Thank you, Elizabeth. So many rich thoughts there. This is just a comment that I would love to hear you comment on, but I'm struck by the persistence of some of these themes into my own lifetime, certainly, and into this moment in time. And I'm just going to pull a few out that occur to me of a longer list. So first of all, you mentioned eloquence, passion, contagion, and their linkage to the body. So this strikes me as a kind of early somatics.
Yeah.
Which we are still, perhaps we think we have invented in the past couple of decades. I'm also thinking of the author whom you mentioned claimed that he could watch a person, perhaps particularly a woman, dance, and he understood her soul. I remember a t-shirt my dance students created that was a quote from Hanya Holm, "When you dance, you are naked." So the early modern dance, the great modern dancers absorbed that same theme and expounded it. Something else that occurred to me when you talked about the waltz, and I know this because I've studied waltzing, is that waltzing was a kind of contact improvisation of its time, finding that common center of gravity and using your partner's weight and pull and creating the dance as you moved together. So it just occurs to me how fluid and continuous some of these themes are. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you, Lynn. Yes, why don't I do them in reverse order? So I like this image, which of course, as I said, these are not these are not illustrations from a dance manual. These are satirical prints that in many ways have more to say about the social reception of the dancing than about the technique of it. So as a dance historian, we have to be very careful not to look at this and say, oh, this is how people held each other, or this is the gesture as it really was performed. But what I like about this particular image, and I'm looking specifically here at the couple where the gentleman has very bright yellow gloves on, and she is wearing a skirt that has a pink bit at the bottom, is if you try to imagine her actually dancing in this position, from a physics perspective, it is not possible that she's still standing up. There is nothing really holding her in place, and it is an illustration of the total failure of the closed couple hold and the negotiation of weight between her partner and herself. He's barely touching her. I don't know if you can see, but he's barely touching her with the tips of his fingers, and her foot here is not even on the floor. So she's got these little slippers on, and she's just barely touching with the underside of her toes. And for me, this is in some ways a provocation of the artist, which is to say that I do think in the very beginning, because this type of image where the postures are just completely in impossible scenarios is repetitive in the satirical prints, I think that there was quite a bit of difficulty in understanding how to hold people in such an intimate way publicly. And this negotiation of weight that you're talking about, I think it doesn't last for the entire form of the waltz. You know, once the dancing masters start to get a hold of it and really treat it as a, what's the word in English? Not regularize. When you formalize a form, and then therefore you begin to instruct it in particular ways, and then it takes on a different nature. But I think in this early period, particularly in the first few years, there was quite a bit of difficulty. I mean, we see it in the novel where the husband doesn't dance it, and so therefore Lotte dances it with Werther. We see it also in Rahel's letters where she's describing, and I unfortunately couldn't present these today, but Rahel Levin in her correspondence with David Veit, goes into great depth about the difficulty that she experiences at a somatic level with mastering this dance. So she talks about the fact that it's very disorienting because you can't see anything clearly. So she's very disturbed by the fact that the informational input at a visual level is not clear, and that it disturbs her mind, but she doesn't want to express it that way. She really hesitates to say that it disturbs her mind, because she recognizes that as a philosopher, because she's really determined to be identified as a philosopher, she runs her own salon, she's also Jewish, and she's living in Berlin, so there are a lot of elements that make it difficult for her to admit that it affects her mind. But finally she does say, it makes me weak, and it is vertigo, and it is about this sensation that everyone's talking about. It takes her quite some time to get there, but her descriptions of learning it demonstrates to me that it really was not obvious from a physical perspective, and that's why I think also we get images like this one, which I didn't develop in any detail, but you know, this is a depiction where the negotiation of weight is, again, it's another depiction of a failure, because you have the man who needs a handkerchief in order to get round his large partner, who herself is in a costume that very clearly for this time period represents French revolutionary woman. She's got the red bonnet on, and this red bonnet actually is one of the costume elements which was formally forbidden at a certain point in the revolution, when women were also formally forbidden from congregating in the coffee houses because they did not want women involved in the political legislation of the new republic. So there's a lot going on in this image which I didn't really have time to develop, but yes, I think not only is this center of gravity, this physical negotiation, something which is also about the somatics of the imagination, as the physicians want it to be, I think it's also very much about a social negotiation. And the time period is for me, very key. You know, you're really in this experimental phase with civil marriage, where it is possible to ask for a divorce. And that, you know, we're no longer in a period of time where if a woman was infidèle, unfaithful to her husband, that he could put her into a convent for 2 years and just leave her there permanently if he didn't want to deal with her anymore. So it's hard for us to imagine today the social importance also of what was going on here. But I think we see it in these satiric images. So yes, Dalera, who says he can understand the soul of the Viennese ladies, it's very difficult to translate the German title, but it's a title where he addresses the German ladies who carry small dogs, who are somehow identified with waltzing. I haven't worked out all of it yet, but it's a very specific, it's also, I think, a slightly light porn work. You know, it's really 14 pages long, and he goes into quite a lot of detail describing the physical effects of the dancing on women's bodies. He doesn't talk at all about the men. So I think also the book, we have to take it in context for what it was. And I think in many ways what he's talking about is seduction. So I'm not so sure that he had the same kind of an eye as a dancing master who's trying to justify dance as an art that can transmit emotion and therefore perform poetics. But again, I think he's more commenting on the sexual aspect of this new dance, which was the first non-courtly dance to be performed in the Saint-Empire. So yes, eloquence, passion, contagion, and the theorization of somatics of dance as something that can speak to hearts. And I completely agree. Thank you for that really wonderful comment. Are there other questions?
I have one, but
yes.
I wonder if you just...
No, please.
Perhaps there are other
I'm
people
here.
As well.
That's
okay, great. Thank you so much. An amazing overview of several centuries and of dance at multiple levels within European society, particularly French. I'm struck by the continuities. I mean, you certainly are showing many, many differences and changes and coupure epistemologique as we move along, but there's also an enormous amount of continuity between the Renaissance and the early 19th century in the themes you bring up. Eloquence, passion, and contagion are present already in the 16th century and are part of a religious discourse against dance. So, and certainly eloquence and rhetoric are very formative, not only for theatrical dance, but for social dance, even in the 16th century and even in the 15th century. So I guess my question is, this is clearly a large project that you're working on, and you are taking in an enormous sweep. I'm not thinking of this as temporally, but an enormous sweep of material. It almost feels a bit Foucauldian to me in the sense that you're not Foucault. Obviously, you're doing something quite different in a way, but in another way, you know, looking at the 17th century in terms of economy, language, you know what I mean? You're using these three categories as he did in the order of things,
yes,
représenter, parler, and échanger as three large tropes for, in a way, taking in an entire culture over a full century. So I know it's, again, with all due respect to all the differences that are happening here and your methodology quite different, but my question really is what are the parameters of this project? In other words, are you dealing with theatrical dance and with social dance alternatively, and as we look at the 18th century and the reforms that led to action ballet, which you discussed at length, bringing into that questions of painting, of gesture, which derive in some ways from eloquence and so forth, respecting those continuities, we're also seeing immense changes. And then we go back to the social dance where questions of political control are more prevalent. So I'm wondering how you're conceiving this entire contribution to dance itself, which I feel is very, very big and very ambitious and powerful, potentially extremely powerful. But I'm also a little bit at sea as to do you really see do you see any difference between, you know, dance on stage, which is a form of artistic expression, and does that employ the same modes of control which have some political implications, or is the social, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? I see these things as very distinct also. How do you bring them all together?
Well, I mean, I think there are also other types of dancing which are significant in the period. You know, you have these very highly choreographed festivals, these revolutionary festivals, where the notion of choreographing unison on large groups is actually quite political. The idea being that they're going to, by that type of choreography, create some kind of republican sentiment that never existed before amongst French people, and also convince people through a kind of a collective embodiment of passion together to agree to be in a policed state with these new rules, and to consider themselves French together, which is not necessarily so obvious for everyone. I think that your question is really puts a finger on one of the most complex problems that I encounter, and I think the only way for me to solve it methodologically is to really follow the through line of the imagination. Mm-hmm. And thankfully, and this is partly why it's even possible to pull these continuities out over such a long period of time, partly the fact that this third aspect of how the powers of the imagination were conceived was so controversial that these texts are easily identifiable. You know, Paracelsus himself was not necessarily the most orthodox of physicians, and there are specific events in which the imagination comes into the popular understanding of, for example, mesmerism and that whole phase right before the revolution where the Royal Commission came forward and basically said, listen, this guy's a quack. He's not curing people. These are the women's imaginations curing themselves. And so brings forward into a very public way these questions about the imagination. And I think that also is why it's so so clearly a through line for the physicians who are trying to understand this. We're also at a critical moment in terms of the birth of what we now call modern psychology. So we don't have that science yet. We're not yet in the era of Charcot, which, you know, is very well developed in the later work that Felicia has, from McCarran, has treated. We're in the period of Pinel, the invention of the first clinic, and really Pinel has this, we would say militant in French, but this political will to suggest that mental illness can be cured. And that's the birth of this kind of science. They are really trying to locate the effects of the imagination and create whole categories of pathologies that are related to what they're calling mental medicine. And I think that if I can stick with the way in which the historical actors understand imagination and its powers, that will give a coherence to the reading. The last chapter, which is not really at all a part of my talk, is going to be a discussion about genius. So with some luck, that will tie things together, but I haven't written it yet. It got sidelined by COVID, and I still need to get back to it. So thank you.
That's fascinating. I do see something of Joe Roach in there, the player's passion, mm-hmm. the medical discourse that mm-hmm. in a way takes within its fold everything theatrical and social around the body mm-hmm. in motion. Mm-hmm. And then Felicia's book, certainly her first book, which
Dance Pathologies.
And I did think of hysteria also as the kind of end point, I mean, the subject
yes,
of hysteria.
Exactly. I mean, hysteria as a medical phenomenon, you know, you can go back to the Renaissance right. and study it, but the fact that it becomes a female disease right. is specific to this time period.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Fascinating.
Are there remote people? Oh, yes. Live people, privileged to the liveness.
Thank you so much, Elizabeth, for your talk. And it's very refreshing, and I have a lot of thoughts. And it's also, like, I'm also thinking about, like, my research about, like, Chinese female body and the male desire for Chinese female body.
Mm.
Like, and also, like, when you talk about, like, the public house, the physical labor and the mental labor, and it recalls me to think about the mental, like the mind and body consistency in Confucianism.
Mm.
And I'm not sure like if this physical labor and mental labor obviously is relates to physicians, the doctors debate, and how it relates to like religions, like Christian. And is there any like influence? And also, when you talk about, like, obviously Marx just said that the the distinction between social dance and ballet, and the idea of like this modernization, like the noble male, the genius, and there's still ongoing debate about like the choreographer as male and the like the and female bodies as being choreographed on ballet stage, and the continuing debate about this, and also for social dance, I'm visioning about like dance as a dance is function as a like a liberation for female, like even the physician considers like it as a disease, like female disease, but in some way I also feel like dance is being like it's a way of female liberation and modernization.
I want to
hear your thought about this.
So I would love to invite you to Paris and we can talk about Confucianism, because I don't know enough about it to respond to that question, but I suspect that we would have quite a lot of things to exchange about. You know, the desire for the Chinese female body is something which contributes, I mean, not just the Chinese female body, but it becomes, in the 19th century, you know, wrapped up in a whole artistic Orientalism, which is extremely present in France and increasingly so towards the end of the 19th century. I'm going to come back to this idea that you spoke to about physical labor and mental labor. There's a wonderful book, fairly recent, by Anthony Lavoppa called The Labor of the Mind. And he, late in his career, decided to try to go back and retrace the 16th, 17th, 18th centuries, looking at the question of gender in terms of the labor of the mind. And one of the things that I've really found quite moving in this work is that we see the different individual voices of women who are reposting. So the debates, and for example, there's also a real question about whether or not the fact that these physicians, in their framing of the powers of the imagination within the female body, whether or not women can participate in that labor of the mind. And I think that's really a very central question that I'm asking implicitly in today's talk, but explicitly in the book project. And this question of the artistic genius who, you know, it's a figure that emerges with the invention of aesthetics and with these new roles for dance performance on stage. And you know, there's been some wonderful research done by Vanina Olivesi, who talks about the feminization of ballet and looks at figures, even the most well-known, like Marie Taglioni, how at the very end of their career, they still have not had any kind of full access to recognition as an author in dance. You know, Marie Taglioni basically is making money teaching dances and choreographing in social dance ballrooms. So it is a critical question for the 19th century. And the 19th century in France and Europe in general is an extraordinarily gendered century in the sort of, let's say, French understanding of gender, which is really about gender binarism. It's a century that really takes that very seriously, partly because it's a cultural experiment in democracy. And I think that is a nervous-making environment for people who are attempting governance.
Are there any other questions or thoughts in the time we have left? I don't see anything on the chat at this point, so no? Okay. I guess we'll have to continue this beyond this the live and broadcast meeting. Thank you. I mean, it's very inspiring what you're doing. The historical sweep of what you're doing, the introduction of the importance of gender into ways of looking at the effects of medicine and theories of the imagination on the body, operating in very different contexts, be they theatrical or social. And as we know, the theatrical emerges out of the social in Europe, and then, you know, there's this dialogue between the two, which we were speaking about in the last session in January, in fact. So I think this is so, as Ying said, it's just very extremely stimulating to all of us to be able to marshal this kind of historical material into dialogues that are, in fact, extremely important now. I
do think that the question of the imagination, and we spoke about that informally together a bit with Lynn earlier, is that the imagination and the body are going to be extraordinarily critical going forward. With the question of artificial intelligence and the limits of that structure of technology, which is an entirely, well, at least in the current version of chatbot and the new things, entirely language-based but written language. And so the database leaves entirely aside the body. And I think it is going to provoke a great deal of question as we move forward. I mean, if we do get to a point where we become cyborgs, we're going to need to understand what is our relevance on this planet. And I'm not sure that it's going to be something that's strictly textual without bodies and without imagination. So I hope that we can continue to study these questions together.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for being here. Thank you all for being there in the universe and to be continued.
Thanks, Mark. Thank you for all of the technical help. And thanks
yes,
to the audience
to the
for coming.
For